Harper Audio presents Son of Rosemary by Ira Levin, performed by Nicole Poole. Part 1. Chapter 1. In Manhattan, on the crisp, clear morning of Tuesday, November 9, 1999, Dr. Stanley Shand, a retired dentist, twice divorced, leaves his apartment on Amsterdam Avenue for his daily constitutional. Though 89, he walks vigorously, his plaid-capped head erect, his eyes bright. He is buoyed both by good health and a secret. A glorious secret that warms his every waking moment. He has been a participant, indeed, has recently become the last living participant in a cosmic event 33 years in the making that is now within 2 months of its ultimate fruition. At Broadway and 74th Street, an out-of-control taxi shoots across the sidewalk and squashes Dr. Shand against the wall of the Beacon Theater. He dies instantly. In that same instant, a few seconds after 11:03 a.m., in the Halsey Bodine Nursing Home in Upper Montclair, New Jersey, the eyes of the patient in room 215 open. They have been closed all the years the woman has been at HB, since 1970-something, as long as anyone can remember. A wizened black nurse massaging the woman's right arm shows extraordinary presence of mind. She gulps, draws breath, and goes on massaging. "Hi, baby," she says softly. "Nice to have you with us." The nameplate on her uniform reads Clarice. Above it hangs an I Heart Andy button. Freeing a hand, she gropes for the nightstand, jabs a push button. The patient's eyes, staring upward, blink. Her lips purse, shiny with salve. She's in her 50s, pale and fine-boned. Her head, its graying auburn hair neatly brushed, rolls toward the side, her blue eyes pleading. "You're going to be fine," Clarice tells her, jabbing the push button, jabbing again. "Don't you worry, you're getting better now." She lowers the woman's arm to the bed. "I'm going to get the doctor," she says. "Don't you worry, be right back." The woman watches her leave. "Tiffany, take off them fucking earphones. Get Atkinson. 215 opened her eyes. She's awake. 215's awake." What in God's name had happened? She'd been sitting at the desk by the bedroom window, around 7 in the evening, while Andy lay on the floor a few feet away watching TV. She was typing a letter home about moving to San Francisco, trying not to hear Kukla and Ollie and the damned coven chanting up a storm next door at Minnie and Roman's. And here she was in a sunny hospital room with an IV in one arm and a nurse massaging the other. Was Andy hurt too? Oh God, please not. Had there been some kind of disaster? Why didn't she remember anything? She got the tip of her tongue out, licked her lips. Minty ointment of some kind coated them. How long had she been asleep? A day? Two? Nothing hurt, yet she couldn't quite move. She worked at getting her throat cleared. The nurse hurried in. "Doctor's coming," she said. "Stay cool." Rosemary whispered, "Is my son here?"
"No, just you. Talking, praise the Lord."
The nurse drew a sleeve down Rosemary's arm, squeezed her hand, and moved to the foot of the bed.
"Praise Jesus."
Rosemary said, "What happened?"
"Don't nobody know, baby. You've been out like a light."
"How long?" Clarice drew a blanket up about Rosemary's shoulders, frowning. She said,
"I don't rightly know. I wasn't here when you came in. You asked the doctor."
She smiled down at Rosemary, Clarice with an I Heart Andy button.
"My son's name is Andy," Rosemary said, smiling back up at her. "Does that heart mean love?"
Clarice said, "That's right." She touched a finger to the round white button.
"I love Andy. They've been doing it for a while now. Different things like I Love New York, anything.
Rosemary said, It's cute. I haven't seen it before. A man in a white jacket excused himself through a few elderly people looking in at the doorway. A large man with ginger hair and a bushy ginger beard. Clarice turned, moving aside as he came in and closed the door.
She's talking and she can move her head.
Hello, Miss Fountain, the doctor said, coming to the bed, smiling at her through his ginger beard. He put his bag and a manila folder on a chair alongside.
I'm Dr. Atkinson, he said, turning down the side of the blanket. This is great news.
He took Rosemary's wrist with warm fingers and looked at his raised watch.
What happened to me? She asked. How long have I been here?
In a moment, the doctor said, studying the watch.
He looked as if under the beard he wasn't much older than she, somewhere in his mid-30s. An ultra-modern stethoscope hung like a slim chrome necktie against his jacket, a Dr. Atkinson nameplate on one side of it, and an I Heart Andy button on the other. An Andy on the staff, she guessed, or a favorite patient. She'd try to get one for herself before she left. Dr. Atkinson let go her wrist, smiling down at her.
So far, so good, he said. Surprisingly so. Bear with me another minute, please. I want to make sure we're not going to lose you again. Then I'll tell you as much as we know. Do you feel any pain?
No, she said.
Good. Try to relax. I know it won't be easy.
It wasn't. As much as we know. Meaning that there were things they didn't know. And the name he had called her, Miss Fountain. An icy hollow grew in her stomach, while the doctor attended to her heart and her eyes and her ears and her blood pressure. She had been there longer than 2 days, she was sure of it. 2 weeks? They had cast a spell on her, Minnie and Roman and the rest of the coven. That was what the heavy chanting was about. They had found out she was taking Andy 3,000 miles away from them, that she had bought the plane tickets. She remembered how they had cast a spell on her old friend Hutch back when she was pregnant, because they were afraid he knew enough about witchcraft, the real kind, to catch on to what they had done to her and whose child she was carrying. Poor Hutch had been in an inexplicable coma for 3 or 4 months and then died. She was lucky to be alive, but what of Andy? He was completely in their hands while she lay there. They'd be feeding and fostering the side of him she tried not to think about.
Damn them, she said.
I'm sorry I didn't get that,
the doctor said, seating himself at the bedside. He hitched the chair closer, leaned his gingery head toward her.
How long?
She asked him.
Weeks? Months?
Miss Fountain.
Riley, she said. Rosemary Riley.
He drew back, opened the folder on his lap, peered downward.
Tell me, she said. I have a 6-year-old son who's in... He's with people I don't trust.
You were signed in here, Dr. Atkinson said, looking down, by a Mr. and Mrs. Clarence Fountain as their granddaughter, Rosemary Fountain.
The Fountains, Rosemary said, belong to this group of people I'm talking about. They're the ones who put me in here. I mean, put me into the coma. Isn't that what it was? An inexplicable coma?
Yes, but a coma isn't...
I know what was done to me,
she broke in, raising herself on an elbow. She fell back. She tried to raise herself again despite warnings and hands. This time she got the elbow back where she could brace herself against it. She stayed up, eye to eye with Dr. Atkinson.
I know what was done to me, she said, but I'm not going to tell you because I know from experience that you'll think I'm crazy. I'm not... I'd appreciate it if you would please tell me how long I've been here and where exactly I am and when I'll be able to go home.
Dr. Atkinson sat back and drew a breath. He looked gravely at her, said,
You're in a nursing home in Upper Montclair, New Jersey.
A nursing home?
She said. He nodded.
Halsey Bodine. We specialize in long-term care.
She stared at him, said,
What day is this?
Tuesday, he said. November 9th.
November?
she said. It was May last night. Dear God! She fell back against the pillow, both hands over her mouth, her eyes staring upward, tears welling. May, June, July, August, September, October, 6 months, snatched from her life, and Andy in their hands all those 6 times 30 days and nights. She saw the doctor still looking gravely at her, still keeping a distance. She raised her hands from her mouth, turned them before her eyes. Their backs, the skin of them was grainy. A brown spot, too? She touched one hand with the fingertips of the other, looked at him.
You've been here a very long time, he said.
Now he leaned close, took her hand and clasped it, held it. Clarice, at the other side of the bed, took hold of her other hand. She looked from one of them to the other, her eyes wide, her lips trembling.
Would you like a sedative?
The doctor asked. She shook her head. No, she said. No, I don't want to sleep again, ever. How old am I? What year is it? He swallowed, tears in his eyes.
It's 1999,
he said. She stared at him. He nodded. Clarice confirmed it, biting her lip, nodding.
You were brought here in September of 1972,
Dr. Atkinson said, blinking.
A little over 27 years ago. Before that, you'd been in New York Hospital for 4 months. The Fountains, whoever they are, set up a trust fund that's been paying for your maintenance here ever since.
She lay back, shut her eyes, shook her head. Impossible, impossible. The coven had won. Andy was fully grown, a stranger, raised by them in their ways, for their purposes. He could be anywhere now, or dead, for all she knew. Oh, Andy, Andy, she cried. Dr. Atkinson, wide-eyed, asked,
How do you know about Andy?
Her son, she mean, Clarice said, patting Rosemary's hand. His name's Andy, too.
Oh,
Dr. Atkinson said and took a breath. He leaned closer, patted Rosemary's hand, and stroked her hair as she lay sobbing.
Mrs. Riley, he said. Rosemary, I know it's small comfort when you've lost so many years, but as far as I know, only two of the people who've been in such long comas have survived, that you've emerged, and emerged so cleanly, in such relatively sound condition. Well, it's a miracle. That's what it is, Rosemary. An absolute miracle.
Chapter 2. They left her alone for a while, after Clarice had wiped her face with a damp cloth and smoothed her hair, and she had sipped down some water. She had asked for the back of the bed to be raised part way. She leaned against the pillow, looking out a window beyond the ivy stand at November trees, fittingly bereft of leaves. She had asked for a mirror, too. Not a good move. She debated, then lifted the plastic handle from the blanket and took yet another wincing look at Aunt Peg wincing back at her. Weird, the likeness. The main difference was that darlin' Aunt Peg had been around 50 the last time Rosemary had seen her, whereas she herself was 58 plus. She had done 31 plus 27 in her head twice and got 58 both times. And Andy was 33. The tears started again. She exchanged the mirror for the clump of moist tissue, blotted both eyes. Get a grip on yourself, old lady. If he's alive, he still needs you. They wouldn't have harmed him physically, of course. They worshipped him. That was the trouble. Being raised by Minnie and Roman Castevet and company, not to mention the frequent adoring visitors from all over the globe, Andy must have grown up as spoiled and overindulged as the worst of the Roman emperors, and maybe as evil as she hated to think who. The coven must have done everything in their power to open and encourage that darker side of him. She had worked against them, hoping to teach him love by loving him, honesty and responsibility by good example, the enlightened Summerhill Creed. Even when he was too young to understand, she had taken him on her lap each evening before... Mrs. Riley? She turned her head toward the doorway. An attractive, dark-haired woman leaned in, about her own age, her age before. The woman's navy suit, smart-looking and not very futuristic, had white piping around its peaked lapels and an I Heart Andy button on one. Smiling, she said, I'm Tara Seitz, the counselor here.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.